The banking industry has seen margins come under pressure following the crises of recent years. How can banks achieve growth amidst the current pressures and challenges?
I think the easiest way to achieve growth is through financial deepening. I think we have to go into the sectors that have not been included in the formal sector. I think we have to go into retail. We have a population, some people say it's not 170. They cannot argue if it's 150. And yet we know that the level of financial deepening or the number of bank accounts is still at the level of 30 something million. So much more needs to be done. So we need to basically bring what is outside the formal sector into the formal sector. That's a starting point. Now, there are also sectors that people are not paying attention to. And working with government, if there are certain things that can be done in agri, it will provide a new sector, perhaps where funding can come in from. But even if you push your retail business, you provide your products with speed which customers deserve, with the kind of service or customer experience which they deserve, and ensure that you're a very safe franchise, what you see is that the sheer velocity of money, okay, and the income that comes from pay and receive, all right, would ensure that you also make reasonable profit. Everybody is going to be affected when there's a downturn. Years of double-digit growth or 100% growth in profits, etc., I think, is going to be tampered with, for a little while.
For a long time now, there have been suggestions for banks to diversify their books, given the amount of lending focused on oil trading and speculation. Now that the oil bubble seems to have burst, how has this affected loan portfolios?
I think it's shifting. I think people are looking for other ways to, the economic animals. So you shift from oil sector, you lend to state governments, you lend to agri, you keep moving. But I think there is a general policy by the central bank around sectoral allocation and therefore managing concentration issues in specific industries. And banks have to comply. So what is likely to happen is that you see a lot more lending moving towards agri. You see a lot more lending moving towards power, which is part of the real sector. And of course, you see a lot more in terms of retail, all right? All of this to diversify income base. But it takes time. It's different from trading. The income doesn't come immediately, all right? But it takes time for those industries to actually get to the point where it would replace the amount of income you were making from what was in those sectors like oil and gas, etc. But the most important thing is that we're helping to build a robust economy for all of us, and then thereby creating sustainable income for the industry. So I think it's a temporary blip, and all of this will be resolved, in the course of time.
Clearly, oil and gas remain very important, but as oil prices fall and foreign reserves dwindle, agriculture is assuming a more important role in the economy. Yet banks are not seen to be supporting agri enough. What are the problems here?
Agri world over needs to be managed, is always managed differently. In Ghana, for instance, you have the commodity bonds. Not only Ghana, even in the US, you have a structure where they guarantee prices for farmers who are bringing their products. Now, we used to have the commodity boards in Nigeria in the early 80s, all right, and they were since scrapped. I think we need to come up with a construct which would ensure that farmers who go to produce basically, all right, would have guaranteed price for their product. That is the first point. The second is that, and that the government is actually doing that, all right, provide a structure where people can move from subsistence farming into mechanized agriculture. Even if they can't afford tractors, you can have people come together by way of a cooperative and have a tractor, which is a much more efficient way of farming, rather than having hoes and shovels, which should be kept in the museum in 2015. So some of those things, if we push them a bit more, I give you an example. There's enough rice. We can grow enough rice in the best strain, acceptable to the local palate, to meet Nigeria's need. And I think some of the things which the central bank has done, by the way, like that one, all right, would encourage those who are growing rice, the paddy, and then the millers, all right, so that we can stop importing rice. So some of these things need to be done. But the government must also provide certain palliatives or incentives to banks who lend in the agri sector. Because agri is not supposed to borrow at double-digit interest rates, if you like, all right, so that all of us will be encouraged. The nature of tax breaks have to be sufficiently generous. Okay, the nature of fiscal stimulus to push people lending in agri needs to be done differently, all right, to encourage more banks to get into it. I keep using neighboring Ghana as an example. I think Nigerian banks, Ghana has a Ghana Cocoa Board, which basically accesses money in the international market to ensure, to help support people and export cocoa on an annual basis. When we look at the sums that they borrow, it is so insignificant. And Nigerian banks are by far so big that they can support all of these things in several multitudes, you know, to the extent that we can actually make sure that even though oil is very rich, we can start to diversify the resource base of our country from it. And all it requires is just for the government to just pay a bit more attention to agri and come up with the various measures to support lending to agri.
We must take a break now. I ask that you please join us again after the break when Herbert and I will be discussing about what it takes to be an Access banker.